FWBC parents. We are so excited. The Discover Ministry is back. We're taking big and bold moves to develop our children right here every first, second, and third Sundays, right in the children's zone. We are fired up and we are ready to go. We are teaching our children on a whole new dimension. But we need you. We need your support. So feel free to contact me and let's talk about how you too can be a part of our beloved children's community. Also, we want to pre-register our children. This is a one-time registration and you will have access to check in within 1 mile. 1 mile before arriving at the church. This is going to be such a great benefit for your family as well as our church. We are so looking forward to you being a part of what we're doing here at the Discover Children's Ministry at FWBC.
Join Seven Seas Enterprise for an electrifying evening of music, comedy, and inspiration at Friendship West Baptist Church on December the 9th for the Uplift Concert with performances by Myron Butler, Victory. Jessica Reedy, Jackie Crystal, Norris J, comedian Trey Mack, and hosted by Trina Jeffery. The Uplift Concert is presented by Seven Seas Enterprise, Inc. For tickets, go to SnoopRobinson.com, Friendship West Baptist Church, or Bailey's Furniture. Produced by Snoop Robinson.
Good morning, Friendship West. Oh, no, you can do better than that. Good morning, Friendship West. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome, welcome, welcome to our brothers and sisters, our e-brothers and sisters online. We welcome you. We thank you. We know that you could be anywhere today, but you're with us. To my brothers and sisters in the house, it is good to be in the house of the Lord. It is good to be in the house of the Lord alive. Let us rejoice in it. My name is Eric with the K. Wilson, and I have with me my wife, my son Josiah Wilson, and one of the future members of Justice Ministry, Amaya. We're here to welcome you this morning. We are here because the Justice Ministry, we are led by God's liberating theology that is preached through Pastor Frederick Douglass Haynes' word, to where that we address justice issues. We address food justice, food deserts. We address economic justice. We address gender justice, and we address civic engagement. And finally, we address economic justice. We need you. We welcome you. I'm here with my members. Raise your hand. And we're here to address those issues in our community that face us. And now I pass it on to the illustrious, the wonderful, the dynamic, God's word bearer, justice drum major, my wife, Cynthia Wilson.
The Bible says, count it all joy whenever you face trials and tribulations. I don't know what you're dealing with today, but whatever you're dealing with, I say that you give it to God because I promise He can handle it. Church, it's prayer time. Shall we pray? Dear most Heavenly Father, we come to you now with bowed heads and humble hearts. Lord, we're praying, dear Heavenly Father, that we hear a word from you. Dear Heavenly Father, whatever we're dealing with, dear Heavenly Father, any distractions, dear Heavenly Father, take it away now in the name of Jesus. Somebody is dealing with sickness in their body. Take away the distraction. Somebody is dealing with the loss of a job. Take away the distraction. Somebody is dealing with their marriage being on the brink of not working. But Lord, take away the distraction. Lord, there are rumors of wars, and wars are happening, dear Heavenly Father. There's oppression and injustice all around us. But Lord, in the name of Jesus, touch everyone that's in the sound of my voice on the top of their head to the soles of their feet. Stir up your spirit in them like never before. Lord, we need to hear from you. Lord, we need a word from you. Lord, we don't know what to do differently, Father, but we need you to touch us in the name of Jesus. So, Lord, as we prepare for worship, we give you all the praise. We give you all the glory, for it is in Jesus' name that we pray. And let the church say amen and amen.
Good morning, Friendship West. Praise the Lord. Good morning, Friendship West. Happy Sunday. Anybody came ready to experience God? I hope you came with a praise on your lips. Y'all ready to praise God a little bit? Can we quartet this real quick? Just a little bit. Say, I need Jesus.
Please lay your hands on me.
I need Jesus too.
Please lay your hands on me.
Come on, let's church it. Come on. Everybody clap your hands.
To peace.
Up, y'all.
Please lay your hands on me.
I need you, Jesus.
Please lay your hands on me.
Oh, Jesus.
Please lay your hands on me.
Hey, said ain't no turning back.
Ain't no turning back.
I need you, that's a fact.
I need you, that's a fact.
Singers, please. Say, Jesus,
please lay your hands on me.
Oh, Jesus, please.
Please lay your hands on me.
Hey, say, ain't no turning back.
Ain't no turning back.
I need you, that's a fact.
I need you, that's a fact.
Jesus, please,
please lay your hands on me.
One more time. Jesus,
please lay your hands on me.
Norwood. Somebody pray for me. They had me on their mind. Took the time to pray for me. Say, I'm so glad they prayed.
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 I'm so glad.
I'm so glad they prayed for me.
Somebody pray. Say,
somebody pray.
Let me hear y'all.
To pray for me.
Come on, say, I'm so glad they pray.
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 I'm so glad she prayed. Can we point at Pastor? Come on, my Pastor. Y'all better be glad your pastor prays for you. Come on, say, I'm so glad they pray.
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 Oh,
I'm so glad they pray.
Break the music. Somebody pray.
Somebody
had me on their mind.
Had me on their mind.
Took the time to pray.
Took the time to pray for me.
Come on, say it. I'm so glad they pray.
I'm so glad they pray.
I'm so glad they pray.
Stay there. I'm so glad they pray.
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 I'm so glad.
I'm so glad they pray for me.
Come on, everybody, clap your hands. Come on, come on. Like a quartet group, come on. Everybody clap your hands. Everybody clap your hands. Say, lay your hands,
lay your hands on me.
I need you, Jesus. Lay your hands.
Lay your hands on me.
Anybody need a touch from him? Say, lay your hands.
Lay your hands on me.
Oh, oh, oh. Lord, lay your hands.
Oh, oh, oh.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Lay your hands. Oh, my Lord. Come on, stay right there. Say, lay your hands.
Lay your hands.
Lay your hands.
Lay your hands.
I need a touch from you. I need a touch from you. Anybody need to be healed? Let me see you wave your hands. Lay your hands. Lay your hands on me, Jesus. I need your power. I need your anointing. Come on and do what you do, Jesus. Come on and do what you do, Jesus. Lay your hands. Lay your hands. I need Jesus. Jesus, lay your hands on me, Jesus. I need a little bit more power. I need a little bit more power. Lay your hand up. Lay your hands.
What do you do, fabulous family of faith? I'm Chris Norman, and I have some information that equips changed people to change the world. Join our beloved First Lady, Sister Deborah P. Haynes, and the Women of the West for another edition of Faith and Fitness with special guest Dr. Jill Wagner for a discussion on knowing your healing scent, Monday, October the 16th at 7 p.m. in the choir room. This event is free and open to the public, but you must register. You can do so by going to friendshipwest.org/events and search for the Faith and Fitness event. Essential oils and teas will be available for purchase. October the 22nd is Breast Cancer Awareness Sunday here at Friendship West. And as we do each year, we want to honor and celebrate the strength of men and women in our congregation who have overcome this disease. We also want to lift and support those who are currently in the fight for healing. If you would like to be featured on the 22nd as a survivor or a current warrior, please submit your photos to Dr. Northfleet by email at mnorthfleet@friendshipwest.org. We're also asking everyone to wear pink in honor of breast cancer awareness on Sunday, October the 22nd.
Dear Dr. Haynes,
don't forget about Mrs. Haynes.
And WBC family!
On every Sunday, you can deliver big bags of candy to the North Eggs.
And WBC, we need you!
Hey, as you just heard, the Ministries of Discover and Chosen, we need your help. Our Fall Faith and Family Festival Trunk or Treat Candy Drive, we are asking for donations of large bags of candy for the kids. You can drop off this candy at the drop-off registration station in the Northex. Also, please stop by our registration station for serving opportunities, as well as to sign up your families to be a part of the festivities. Join Friendship West as we relaunch the Howard Thurman Bible Institute November the 6th through the 8th. HTBI offers practical life enrichment classes and advanced biblical studies for persons interested in advancing their spiritual growth and knowledge of God. We will offer a variety of courses for every life stage and spiritual need. For more information, registration, or to view the classes offered, visit www.htbibleinstitute.org. Our annual Thanksgiving celebration with our VIPs is coming up soon, and we need you to help serve on Thanksgiving morning at the 616. This powerful experience pairs serving and worshiping as we fellowship and share with our VIPs. Join us by visiting friendshipwest.org/events to register. We hope to see your face in the place.
Please support the annual eye care donation drive from October 15th to December 3rd. You can donate clothing, school uniforms, undergarments, coats, shoes, socks, gloves, personal hygiene items, and school supplies. You can drop off your donations on Sundays at the Eye Care Donation Table located in the Narthex in the Pastoral Suite or during the week at the reception desk. Or you can make a financial contribution online at Friendship West, Giving Platforms, or scan the QR code. Bless our eye care students, families, teachers, and school administrators.
West Wall Street is back, and it will be held on Sunday, December the 3rd. If you own a business and you want to participate in this year's West Wall Street Holiday Edition, please visit friendshipwest.org/west-wall-street to begin the registration process. The submission deadline is, of course, November the 1st, and space is limited. To see if your business qualifies, check out the rules and criteria on the West Wall Street page by visiting friendshipwest.org, scroll over to the resource tab, and select West Wall Street. There are several ways that you can connect with all things here at Friendship West. You can stop by the Connection Center in the Northex every Sunday to find out ways to get involved in ministries as well as volunteer opportunities. You can also visit our website and scroll over to the Connect tab. There you will find more information about prayer, prayer requests, volunteer opportunities, as well as a list of ministries you might be interested in joining. And in the words of our senior pastor, don't wait, don't hesitate, don't vacillate. Visit friendshipwest.org, scroll over to the Connect tab to get connected to the ministry that best fits your needs. You can also stay locked in with all things Friendship West by following us on all social media platforms as well as subscribing to our YouTube channel. You can also sign up for text alerts by simply texting FWBCINFO to the number 28950. That's right, text FWBCINFO to the number 28950. Do it right now. Pull out your phone, text FWBCINFO to the number 28950. Well, unfortunately, that's all I have for you for this week's edition of What's Happening at the West. But before we go, we would like to thank our visitors who took the time to check us out this Sunday. We know that you could have went anywhere else in the world, but you decided to worship with us. And for that, we're grateful. And if you have a church home, we're praying for you and that pastor as well as that ministry. But if you are church homeless, we would love for you to join us. And Pastor Haynes would love to be your pastor here at the Wild Wild West. We're large enough to serve you, but we're also small enough to love you. So in your search for a church, you can end your quest at Friendship West. Why? Because at Friendship West, we ain't got nothing but love for you. Until next time, deuces.
Good morning, Friendship West family.
Good morning.
I need to hear y'all talk back to me. Good morning, Friendship West family.
Good morning.
My name is Toya Smith, and we are the Justice Ministry. Today, we are partnering with Bread for the World for Bread Sunday. and we need you to take action. Food insecurity and hunger impact all communities, but most importantly, it impacts our community the most, particularly our children. I want to direct your attention to the screens to provide you and our online audience with critical data related to the issue of hunger. Between 2019 and 2021, Black households experienced food insecurity at 3 times the rate of white households. You can go to the next one. Between 2019 and 2021, Texas was the 6th hungriest state, with a food insecurity rate 32% higher than the national average of 10.4%. SNAP helps 1 in 10 workers in Texas put food on the table. 1 in 4 African American children in Dallas County are experiencing food insecurity. You can take a step to end hunger and food insecurity right now. Grab your phone and scan the QR code on the screen. That QR code will direct you to a form letter. Make sure you enter our home, Friendship West Baptist Church, Dallas, Texas, in the church and organization field. This letter will go directly to your congressional representative, asking them to support just and equitable food policies. If you didn't get a chance to catch the QR code, if your phone isn't quick enough, if technology is not working with you, that is okay. In the narthex, we will have a table where you will be able to scan that QR code and send a letter to your congressional representative on the way out. I urge you to consider this scripture. Luke 6:21 states, "Blessed are you who are hungry for now, for you will be filled." It is God's will that people have healthy, quality food to eat and not go hungry because of greed and a disregard for people who are marginalized. Thank you, Friendship West. Thank you, Pastor Ayers, for your leadership. And thank you, Dr. Haynes, for your willingness to pursue justice in the face of injustice. Let us go to God in prayer. Lord, we thank you for this Bread Sunday and pray for our leaders in Austin and Washington. May you give them the divine wisdom to lead and serve. Heavenly Father, in a world that prioritizes weapons of war over the poor, may we not lose sight of the fact that our hope is in you. Let us pray for the health of women, children, and families, for an end to maternal and child mortality. Send life-giving rains at just the right time. Pour out your grace on hungry families, especially on parents straining to feed their children in the face of dwindling resources. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
Speak. will your heart and soul say yes? And will your spirit still say yes? For there is more than I require of thee. So will your heart and soul say yes? Will your heart and soul say yes? Will your mind and soul say yes? Will your spirit still Whoa. Will your heart and soul say yes? God declares for your life, for this is more than I require of thee. You can do it today. Will your heart and soul say yes? Yeah. this is more than I require of you. He has a call on your life, I guarantee you. Oh, this is more than I require of you. Everything you know in your heart you could be doing, just say yes to him, for there is more than I require of you. If you receive that today, receive it now. There is more. There is more that I, there is more that I require of thee. Help me say, if you believe it, hear him say to you, there is more.
There is more that I require of thee.
You can do more. You can go more. You can be more. You can do it. Say yes, there is more.
There is more that I require of thee. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, I'll go.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yeah.
Can I say this?
I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your whole will and to your way. I'll say. Yes, yes, yes. Come holler, how I
y'all say yes. Have your way. 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 My soul says yes. My soul says yes. Anybody got a yes in their spirit? Yes, Lord. Yeah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Open your mouth to see, yes, Lord. Open your mouth to see, yes, Lord. Open your mouth to see, yes, Lord. Yeah, 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 yes, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, it's in my spirit, I will see, yes, it's in my heart, I will see, yes, the devil tried to take me out, but Lord, I will see, yes, 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 ah, yeah. My soul says, 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 yeah, 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 yeah.
Thank you for your will. Thank you for your way. Thank you that you love us enough to know what's best for us. Thank you that you have a plan and a purpose for us. And so, God, because you are good, because you are great, whatever your plan is, whatever your will is, we say yes. Yes, Lord. To your will, yes, Lord. To your way, yes, Lord. We thank you for being God and for being good. And we thank you, oh God, for how you have ordered our steps and even our stops, bringing us to this encounter with you. And right now, God, you know what we are going through. You know what we are dealing with. You know what we are up against. We need a word from you. We need to hear from you. If we don't hear from you, what shall we do? So please, remove any distractions that may get in the way of us hearing from you. Don't let me or anything in me or about me get in the way of what you are up to, what you want to say to us in this moment. So speak, Lord. We are ready. We want to hear from you. Speak, Lord. I'm available to be used as your instrument, so stand in my body. Take over my mind and think your thoughts. Take my mouth now and speak with power your word. Bless your word. And may your word go forth with such power that none of us online or in the house leave this experience the same way we came. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and hallelujah. Praise God for our praise team. They set this on fire. Thank you, praise team. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, we find the words of our text for this message. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14 reads, "And if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land." You may be seated in God's presence. For just a few moments, with your prayers, I want to continue our stroll through this wonderful verse. And today I want to talk about going to your knees to get back on your feet. Going to your knees to get back on your feet. Has life ever set you back, knocked you down, and threatened to wipe you out? No matter how big your Bible is, how long you've been going to church, there are those dark days and nightmarish nights where we find ourselves literally wiped out. We've been set back and we are knocked down. Have you ever undertaken something that is huge and now it's dawning on you what you've undertaken is a bit much for you? Or perhaps you've been overwhelmed by circumstances that have come up out of nowhere, and now you're wondering if you have what it takes to deal with what is threatening to knock you down, set you back, and wipe you out. I read something in one of our periodicals about something going on in the state of Maine. Forever Chemicals has literally poisoned the land. One particular farmer by the name of Adam has this testimony. Adam said that he had bought a farm with the hopes of not only raising cattle, but on top of that, it was Adam's dream to raise crops. But he discovered that the land he purchased had been poisoned by Forever Chemicals. Right. As a consequence, even the crops he did produce were poisoned. And as a consequence, hear Adam's testimony as he welcomes a reporter to check out his land and declares, "Welcome to the ghost town of my dreams." What a metaphor. Welcome to the ghost town of my dreams. Perhaps you're unfamiliar with ghost towns. Ghost towns are those towns that have literally been abandoned. They used to be thriving with life and energy, but now there's no one there. Perhaps there is the remaining leftover infrastructure, but no one is in this town that has been abandoned. And listen to the testimony of Adam as he says to this reporter, welcome to the ghost town of my dreams. That's powerful right there, because in a real sense, Adam is testifying through that metaphor that he himself has given up on his dreams. He is testifying that what he once was looking forward to had fallen through, and now his dreams are empty. Welcome to the ghost town of my dreams. And you understand why Forever Chemicals was much more politically powerful and economically strong than Adam himself. And so Adam is up against something that is too much for him. He is overwhelmed. He had undertaken something that was large, but now because of what's against him, it's not going to get done. And Adam's testimony is, welcome to the ghost town of my dreams. I don't know who God has brought to church today, or perhaps you are watching this online, and Adam's testimony resonates with you because there was something in your life that you were looking forward to, but things have fallen through because what you were undertaking, now you feel overwhelmed, and as a consequence, you've experienced a setback. You have been knocked down, and your dreams have been wiped out. That's the testimony of Adam, but also somebody in the house, somebody online, that's your testimony. Something you have undertaken has become overwhelmingly against you, and now you find yourself, after so many setbacks, you have been knocked down, and life is threatening to wipe you out. Well, that did not get you. I'll see if I can make this real plain, my sisters and brothers, because in a real sense, all of us from time to time find ourselves in predicaments that are quite problematic. All of us find ourselves wondering if we have what it takes to do what it is we feel purposed by God to do, and yet life happens, and when life happens, we find ourselves set back and sometimes knocked down, and it seems like we're going to be wiped out. Well, my sisters and brothers, I guess I could park right here parenthetically and point us in the direction of what is called the Middle East, because right there in the Middle East, backed by this United States government, we see a people that are being literally threatened to experience ethnic cleansing. They're being threatened to literally be wiped out. Now, I park right here because some of you may get upset with me because it appears I'm talking bad about Israel. No, I'm not talking bad about Israel, but I am talking bad about ethnic cleansing. I am talking about killing. I am talking bad about senseless murder. I am talking bad about treating God's children as if they are less than human. And my sisters and brothers, have you picked up on the fact that what is going on over there? To be sure, what Hamas did was absolutely low down. It was evil. Persons who had gone to a concert to enjoy themselves, they had left their family at home, and now some will never go back because of what happened 8 days ago. But hold on, look what they declared. Israel, led by their Trump-like leader, had the nerve to say, Netanyahu is his name. Netanyahu said, this is our 9/11. Uh-oh, I think we need to talk right here, because if it is their 9/11, check out how this country responded to 9/11, because if any country ought to be able to tell another country how to respond right and how not to respond to your 9/11, surely it ought to be this country, because what this country did in response to 9/11 is nothing short of evil. Look what this country did, lying about weapons of mass destruction. Look what this country did, killing over 100,000 Iraqi citizens. reasons that had nothing to do with 9/11. Wait, I'm not even done, because I just gave you a number of the number of Iraqi citizens that were killed, but we never got that on our news feeds in this country, because the only lives that counted in this nation's media were American lives that were lost over at the so-called war on Iraq. But hold on, I'm not even done, because my sisters and brothers, this country, when the world rallied around us, mismanaged and was a bad steward of that support, and used its own power in order to take innocent lives, and no good has come out of that. Can you tell me one good thing that came out of the so-called Iraqi war? I'm not even done, because that's exactly what's being replicated now in Palestine, because the sad reality is Gaza already an open-air prison, already a place of people who are vulnerable consistently. And please understand, because I see y'all looking at me strange, that Israel today ain't biblical Israel. I need to be real clear about that, because Israel today, please understand this, that this nation and other Western nations, beginning at the beginning of the last century, was looking for a plot of land in order to give to Jews. They even went to Uganda and Kenya, but said, no, that's a little too much melanin there, and they settled on the current area where they are. And so there were people already living there. There were indigenous people, the Palestinians, who were already living there. And this and this country and other Western countries made up their mind that they were going to literally displace the indigenous people and then place in their land, their own homeland, place in their homeland and create the modern nation Israel. Now, please tell me how you would feel if somebody came to your house and told you that you've got to go to the basement or the attic and you stay there. I'll decide if you get electricity. I'll decide if you get food. I'll decide what you can get. No wonder when Desmond Tutu, Archbishop Desmond Tutu, visited Israel and Palestine, he said it blew his mind how similar what the Palestinians were going through with what he went through when he was under apartheid rule in South Africa. I'm trying to let y'all know that there was something, because it's a lie when they say we were surprised by the attack from Hamas. Oh, you've been kicking my behind all this time, and you think ain't nothing gonna happen now? To be sure, I am not advocating violence, because Israeli lives are as valuable as Palestinian lives, and I'm not saying anybody should be dead. Oh, I think I'll park right there, because the bottom line is the Israeli prime minister referred to the Palestinians as human animals, and once you see people as less than human, Gray Carr says all bets are off, and what you do is you treat them as roaches to be exterminated, as a problem you've got to get rid of, instead of recognizing they are humans, they are God's children. Oh, I see y'all getting mad, because some clapped back at me last week and said, but God said that God was going to bless everybody that blessed Israel and curse everyone that cursed Israel. First of all, biblical Israel, modern day Israel ain't the same. Secondly, since you're such a Bible scholar, have you ever heard about the passage that said God so loved the world that God gave on God's only begotten son? I guess y'all don't like that part, because some of us don't want everybody to be loved by God. But the God I serve said, I so love the world. I love Palestinians. I love Jews. I love black folk. I love indigenous folk. I love Asians. I love Europeans. I love white folk. I love Africans. Africans. I love everybody. I created the world. And whenever you treat people as less than human, when you treat people as less than human, you are sinning against the God that created them. And so, needless to say, disappointment is all in my spirit when I see how this nation has responded. Look at this nation with the nerve of the president and every person in Congress except the squad that had the courage of their convictions as they rush to say, the president, Black Caucus, congresspersons, we stand with Israel. Why don't you say we stand for life? Why don't you say we stand against violence? Why don't you say we stand against genocide and ethnic cleansing? Why don't you say you stand for what's right and what's just? Because as long as we don't stand for what's right and what's just, then we have, watch this, Israeli insecurity that is rooted in Palestinian injustice. Oh boy, I should have known y'all feel this way, but I'll go ahead and get to the stuff that makes y'all shout, okay? Because I had to get that out the way and at least give you a sense of what's going on. And I promise to do a Bible study on this real soon so we can have Q&A and dialogue about this, because a lot of stuff is out there that really ain't consistent with Scripture, let alone the will of God. And so understand that now people experience being set back and knocked down and threatened to be wiped out. And yet, my sisters and brothers here, when we feel helpless, like Adam must have felt here when we wonder if we are going to make it out of whatever we find ourselves up against going through, and wondering if we can accomplish the assignment that God has for us that is huge and sometimes overwhelming. Here is what God says. God's word says, and if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I got to shout you, because in verse 13, right before 14, God says, if I send drought, if I send pestilence, if I send locusts. Now watch what gets me is that we dealt with locusts last week. Today I want to talk about pestilence, because I unpack pestilence. Pestilence is death dealing. Pestilence is when you find yourself in a situation where death is all around you. People are dying, and because they are dying, it is traumatic. It is causing grief within your spirit. But look what my Bible says. The Bible says, even if pestilence comes, there's power in prayer. Because if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. Y'all didn't shout. I got to do it for you one more time. If pestilence comes and death is all around you, and you want to know how to stop death so it gives way to new life, if my people called by my name humble themselves and pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. I love this, y'all, because I've discovered, and this is what Harry Emerson Fosdick says in a sermon entitled When Prayer Means Power. He says, we accomplish things in life by working, thinking, and praying. Now we know that we get things done by working. We work with our hands and we make a difference. But sometimes it's not just your hands that have to work, it's your head that has to work. And so we think with our minds and open the door to new eras of possibility. But y'all, every now and then, as hard as you may work, as good as you may think, there are situations you can't think your way out of. There are situations you can't work your way out of. You need a power beyond your power to help you get done what only God can get done. And so we work with our hands, and you got to do that. If you want to get stuff done, you got to work with your hands. Quit saying, I'm waiting on God. God may be waiting on you to work with your hands to get some stuff done. But then we use our minds, and we use our minds to critically analyze and think our way into a new era of possibilities. But after that, text says, you got to pray. You got to pray. And y'all, I'm here to say that when we pray effectively and powerfully, this is going, and please don't miss this, effective, empowered prayer is the result of a consciousness of great need. And the consciousness of great need is the result of undertaking something you know you can't get done in your own power, but also you're conscious of a great need because you are overwhelmed by all that life keeps hitting you with. And when you feel overwhelmed by what life hits you with, and you are undertaking something that's too big for you, now you are in a position to get your real prayer on. And at that point, prayer becomes powerful. Prayer becomes game-changing. Prayer gives you power to do what you can't do, because now you have access to power that's going to get some stuff done. Y'all didn't shout, I'm in the Bible. The Bible says Peter was thrown in jail, and when he was thrown in jail, the church could not think their way out of the situation. They could not work their way out of the situation. They could not pay their way out of the situation. And my Bible says they prayed, and when they went down in prayer, the Bible says God went to work, and God sent an angel. And I came by to tell somebody, God is still sending angels. Every now and then, God will send an angel and open up a door you did not knock on. Is there anybody here who can testify you prayed, and after you gave it over to God, God worked out what you could not figure out? God worked out what you did not have the power in your hands to do. Jesus can work it out. The church prayed. Okay. So I did my homework, and etymologically, I unpacked the word. If my people call my name, I'm going to say, pray. That word pray is the most common word in all the Hebrew Bible for prayer. It was often used in seasons of distress. It's used by Hezekiah. When Hezekiah gets a diagnosis, you're going to die. And the text says Hezekiah prayed. He could not think his way to healing. He could not work his way to healing. And so Hezekiah prayed. And the Bible says when he turned his face to the wall, God watched this, said, all right, Hez, I'm going to give you 15 more years. He got 15 more years, and the doctor said. So can you imagine Hezekiah's doctor showing up and saying, you're supposed to be dead, Hez. And Hezekiah says, I got another doctor. I got a second opinion. And the second opinion doctor has extended my prognosis. Oh, I gotta stop and give y'all time to shout right there, because Hezekiah from heaven is saying God is a healer. When other folks say they can't do anything, God says I specialize in what other folks say they can't get done. God says when you've done all you can, just stand. And while you're standing, I'll show up and heal you. While you're standing, I'll give your body back to you, and you'll bounce back stronger, wiser, and better because of what you've been through, because now you've experienced my power. Okay, y'all didn't feel Hezekiah? What about Hannah? Hannah. Hannah was being hated on by her rival because Hannah couldn't have children. Oh my God.
Hannah was barren, and the book says she prayed, same word, and when she prayed, the book says God opened up her womb, and Hannah gave birth to a child that blew everybody's mind. What she could not do, she was now able to do, because prayer, watch it, she couldn't think it, she couldn't work it, but she could pray it. And God sent me to tell somebody, what you can't think for a solution, what you can't work for a solution, God says pray. And when you pray with a sense of need, God will. God will. Oh, God will. I need some God will witnesses in here. God will. God will. Watch this, watch this, watch this. I love this because the text lets us know that even in pestilence, God will. God is able. In the midst of pestilence, death-dealing circumstances, that's what we have going on. Wait, not just in Palestine, we got it going on in this country. Black mothers dying senselessly because of a system that doesn't listen to black women. Listen, don't miss this Breast Cancer Awareness Month. Y'all, I was in Charleston, South Carolina this week preaching, and I was leaving early Thursday morning, had the news on to keep up with what's going on, and all of a sudden, they're interviewing a sister as a part of their Breast Cancer Awareness Month series. And the sister said that when she was diagnosed with breast cancer, she went into a dark place. And she went on to testify that while she was in that dark place, that's when God showed up as the only light that she could have. And her testimony is that she turned to God in prayer. And when she turned to God in prayer, she partnered prayer with getting with a good physician. And she had got a good physician, and the partnering of the two changed life for her so much so that today her testimony is, I've come out of the darkness into the marvelous light because God is a healer. I'm a cancer survivor. And that's her testimony. And I came to let somebody know there's power in prayer, because y'all, she could not think her way to a healing. She could not work her way to a healing, but she could discover that when life knocks you down and sweeps you off your feet, that means you've hit your knees. And once you've hit your knees, you're in praying position. I'm trying to let somebody know, if my people called by my name humble themselves and pray, 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 pray. I hear you talking to me, Freddie Haynes. I feel this. I want a stronger prayer life. I want a prayer life that connects me with my Creator so much so that what I can't think through and work through, I can pray through. If that's you, let me unpack this and we'll be done. Because basically, when you get a stronger prayer life, it's because you recognize that in prayer, you got to have a personal connection. In prayer, there are prerequisite conditions, and then you experience powerful consequences. That's where I'm going, and we're going to wrap this thing up. Number one, prayer means that when you pray with the sense of personal connection. If my people called by my name, you didn't shout. When you pray with a sense that you are personally God's. That didn't shout you. You belong to God. And so when I'm praying, I hit my knees to get back on my feet, but I pray with the consciousness that God personally cares about me, personally is engaged with me. Y'all, God is more than Origin's unmoved mover. God is more than the philosopher's uncaused cause. God runs the universe But God is such a God that God says, I number the hairs on your head. Oh, I want to make sure I include everybody. I number the follicles that don't grow hair anymore. Okay, that didn't get some of y'all. Oh, I number the tracks in your weave. I'm just simply trying to say that God is so good that God knows you intimately. God knows you personally. God cares about you. And God says, I know you better than you know you. And I'm personally engaged with you. So every time I pray with the consciousness that God is personal. I've got a personal connection with the King of Kings. I've got a personal connection with the Lord of Lords. I've got a personal connection with the Creator of the universe. Wait, y'all didn't shout. If my people called by my name, I got a personal connection with Yahweh, Elohim, El Elyon, El Shaddai, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Shalom. I got a personal connection with that God, the same God that showed up for Abraham as Jehovah Jireh is my God, the same God who showed up for Moses as Jehovah Nisi and will fight your battle. That's my God, the same God who is Jehovah Rapha, the same God who is Jehovah Shalom. That's my God. Y'all, it will energize and encourage your prayer life when you know when you are praying, God is personally engaged. Listen, Pastor Maguru, this messed me up. I saw this and I've read this passage so often, but this finally hit me. Jesus said, when you pray, don't be like the heathens. Or the Pharisees, I'm sorry, out there praying all loud so everybody can hear them. They showing off how holy they are. He said, no, here's what you do. When you pray, go into your inner chamber, your prayer closet, and God, who sees you in secret, will reward you in public. Now, here's what I had never gotten before. I got the part that I go into my prayer closet, God sees what's happening, and then publicly, I blow up. I get that. But here's what messed me up. Jesus said, go into your inner chamber, your prayer closet, your private space. Ain't nobody but you there. And God sees you. Meaning, I always pray with the sense I ain't by myself. I pray with the sense that power I'm praying to is so close to me, even if I'm by myself, I ain't alone. Freddie Haynes, you're not by yourself. God is right there with you, listening, engaging with you. When you pray, you're not by yourself. That didn't get you. Thank you, doctors. I'm wondering if they're feeling this thing right now. So watch it. If my people called by my name, that's hot right there. If my people, I belong to God. God is personal. And since God is personal, when I pray, even in my alone time, I'm not by myself because God is right there with me as I'm praying. If my people called by my name. And then this gets me. Humble themselves and pray, seek my face. Uh-oh. That means after our personal connection, there are prerequisite conditions. You can't just come into God's presence any kind of way. My late mentor, Emmanuel Scott, put it like this way. You can't live any kind of way and expect your prayers to go through. Okay, I'm not making this up. If my people call by my name, humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways. So meaning, if you're not careful, you can get in the way of your prayers being answered if you don't fulfill the prerequisite conditions. And the text lets us know what the prerequisite conditions are. Humble yourself. You can't just barge off into God's presence and act like you all that. God knows you all that because God made you all that. So don't barge off into God's presence without recognizing that God is all that term. Claudius in Shakespeare's play, Hamlet? He is low down. I mean, he had his brother killed and then took his brother's wife and then went to church. And he gets to church and has the nerve to try to pray. This is the line. It's going to kill you. My words go up, but my thoughts remain below. And words without thoughts never to heaven go. Okay. Forgive me, but I got to show off my education, okay? So in Shakespearean poetry and even in the plays, Shakespeare is always, watch this, speaking beyond the surface meaning of the words. So when my words go up, my prayers are going up, but my thoughts are low. So if my thoughts are low, that means my thoughts have nothing to do with the words coming out of my mouth. I'm praying up to a great God that is above me and beyond me. But here's the deal. My thoughts are on the dirty deeds I'm doing. And because of the dirt I'm doing, even though I'm saying the right stuff, my heart is not in it. And because my heart ain't in it, then God ain't hearing it. Okay. So there are prerequisite conditions. Humble yourself. Oh my God, let's start right there. The Hebrew really is falling on your knees. I just got triggered earlier this year, and I was tripping because I'm usually doing good with my asthma, but earlier this year I'm traveling and I had a bad asthma attack. I had an asthma attack. I'm in a hotel room, and asthma's bad enough no matter where you are, but away from home, my asthma hit me, and so I basically had to make sure I had my inhaler with me at all times. And so I'd gone to sleep, and my inhaler was supposedly on the side of the bed on the little thing right there. And y'all check out what happened. I wake up, and I go to the bathroom. After going to the bathroom, I'm not breathing well. And so I go rushing, trying to find my inhaler. It feels like an elephant is on my chest. I go to the last place I had my inhaler and check it out. It's not there. I am messed up, and I'm breathing and struggling to breathe and struggling to breathe until finally I hit my knees. But once I hit my knees, my perspective was different, because unbeknownst to me, somehow I had knocked my inhaler off of the little desk adjacent to the bed, and it had slid right under the bed. And because I was on my knees, I could see what I could not see. As long as I was standing up all high and mighty, come here, I'm about to get somebody. Every now and then, God will let life sweep you off your feet, fall down on your knees, but now you have real connection to Almighty God. I got that inhaler, and in the name of Jesus, I went to pumping, and I got back up on my feet because I had first been driven to my knees. Is there anybody here who can say, you just gave my testimony? I've been there where I tried to do it on my own, but life knocked me down. But while I was down, I got on my knees and God heard me. Humble themselves and pray. Here it is. And seek my face. Seek my face. It literally means to get in the presence of God. So when I'm praying, here it is, I do all I can to practice the presence of God. Oh, help me. Now here's what's interesting. I'm be honest with you. It ain't always easy. ain't always easy, because there's some days just ain't feeling God. And I ain't feeling good, and I ain't feeling God. Okay, you judging me, because you always feel good and you always feel God. No, no, that ain't life. And y'all, I've discovered this. Watch this. There are some areas that you drive in on our side of town, where if you were talking to someone, and I know it's right there at I-35 and around Luke 12. Man, if you're talking to someone, all of a sudden, phone either dies or y'all can't hear each other. Yeah, on our side of town, our side of town. Yeah, yeah. AT&T is our headquarters, and we got these dead areas. Yeah, I'm calling you AT&T headquarters here in Dallas, and we got dead areas. All right, I'm sorry. So, but here it is. You're driving along, talking to somebody, and all of a sudden, either you can't hear them, or call drops.
Right.
It hit me. I can't hear them, or the call drops, because I'm in a dead area. Okay. And it's hard to communicate with who you want to communicate with when you're driving or walking in a dead area. They're going to shout in just a moment, because a lot of times when I'm praying, I'm in a dead area. And because I'm in a dead area, I can't hear from God. God, in a real sense, is trying to get through. But God is saying, you're in a dead area. What do I do when I'm in a dead area? I keep on driving. I don't stay in that dead area. I drive on through that dead area until I get a better signal. And so Jesus said, Jesus taught his disciples to always pray and not faint. Did y'all get that? And tells a parable about a sister, a widow woman. Jesus is something else, because he knows sisters are relentless. And so what Jesus does, Jesus tells a parable about a sister who is not experiencing justice, and the judge says, leave me alone. And the text says she's a sister. Keeps on knocking. Keeps on knocking. And the judge says, you know what? I don't fear God. I don't fear nobody. But you're working my last nerve. And because of your relentlessness, I'm going to go ahead and give you justice. Because she kept on driving. Even through the dead area, somebody needs that word right now, because you've been feeling like your prayer life is in a dead area. I'm saying keep on driving it, but I'm also saying here's the good news. When you know Jesus, you are blessed, watch this, with a satellite phone prayer life. Now, Brooke Baldwin, CNN was in Mexico City in the aftermath of devastation, earthquake. Uncle Vinny, look what happened. Brooke Baldwin has a satellite phone because the devastation had knocked out the cell towers. And because the cell towers were knocked out, cell phones weren't working. But she has a satellite phone. And so her satellite phone is connected to the satellite. Duh, you didn't shout. Here it is. If it's a satellite phone connected to a satellite, it's connected to something beyond the earth that still has range and power on this earth. And so what she did when somebody was in need, she let them use the satellite phone. But here is what shouts me, and that is the fact that it's a satellite phone, it means it has to have direct contact or be in direct line with the satellite. And so if it's in a building, it will not work. If there's something covering it, it will not work. So what do? You reposition yourself so the satellite can pick up where you are, and once the satellite picks up where you are, even devastation around you can't stop you from the connection that the satellite has for you. It does. depend on me. When you know Jesus for yourself, there may be devastation all around you, but just keep repositioning yourself in prayer. And God beyond this earth has range on this earth, and God will hear you. All right. So you have personal connection. Prerequisite conditions. Ah, but that yields some powerful consequences. Here comes your shout, and I'm done. If my people called by my name humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then I'm gonna hear from heaven. Heaven is gonna hear about your hell on earth. I'll hear from heaven, forgive their sin. You didn't shout. Whatever you've done that gets you in the way of you, God says, I release you. I release you from you. I release you from what you did that causes you to feel guilty. I release you from it. It no longer is in between you and me. I release you from it because I'm God, a God of grace. I'm going to go ahead and just say, amazing grace. How sweet the sound saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, now I'm found. Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. It was grace that bought my liberty. I don't know why God came to love me so. God looked beyond my faults and saw my needs. So I'll forgive their sin and I'll heal the land. Heal the land. Let me quit by giving you this. I was in Charleston, South Carolina. I told you earlier this week. So Monday, as soon as I landed, I was hungry. So I went to like my favorite restaurant there. It's called Hannibal's, Gucci Gullah kind of place. And so I go there to grub, and when I got to Hannibal's, it was like around 3 o'clock, so it wasn't a lot of folk in there. Hannibal's is the kind of place, they have Barack Obama's been there, a lot of the stars have been there. And so Angela Bassett, I see her picture up on the wall. So I go to Hannibal's, and once I get to Hannibal's, I sit down because I got a table to myself, a table for four, but it's just me. And so about 5 minutes later, this place is packed. It's just packed. And so there is an older sister with her daughter, and they've come in to the restaurant, and the restaurant is packed. There are no seats. And so I'm sitting there, and my food is on the way, and this is sister standing up. That's somebody's mama, and her daughter, that's somebody's sister or somebody's mama. And so I just said, okay, y'all want to sit with me? Y'all want to sit with me? And so I didn't know it, but the older sister was blind. And so she said, oh, thank you, son. And so she sat down. And when she sat down, her daughter sat down, looked at me. Her daughter looks at me and then whispers to her mama, mama, we sitting with Pastor Haynes. She has a distinct accent. She says, mama, we sitting with Pastor Haynes. And so I said, okay, what's your name since y'all know me? And the mother answers and said, child, I watch you every Sunday. Told you she's blind. Child, I watch you every Sunday. And so I said, so, you know, me thinking I'm all smart, I said, I really appreciate you tuning in and listening. And she said, I said, I watch you every Sunday. Just because I'm blind doesn't mean I don't have vision. I guess she told me. Oh, I'm liking this woman. I'm liking her some. I mean, I'm loving her. And again, she has a distinct accent. And so, Dr. Thomas, Floyd Thomas, here's what happened. I said, excuse me, my bad. Totally my bad. She said, you're going to probably preach about me, huh? So I fell out. out laughing when she said, I mean, all I could do was laugh because I mean, she wasn't lying. And I'm preaching about her today. Hey. And so here's what happened, y'all. Here's what happened. She said, I tune in, I watch you every Sunday, and your word got me through the pandemic. And she said, I just happened during the pandemic to be on YouTube going through all these pastors, but your message hit me because your message, you connect what's going on with me personally and spiritually with what's happening in this world. Amen. And I like that kind of gospel because I'm from, watch this, I'm from Rwanda. I'm from Rwanda, and I survived that horrific slaughter that took place in the 90s. I survived it. My daughter survived it, and my daughter got kidnapped during that horrific slaughter. She was with me. We're together walking down the street, and this gang came up. They grabbed her, and when they grabbed her, they put her on the back of this motorcycle, and I am standing there screaming, and the screaming I discovered was not getting me anywhere, and so I decided instead of screaming, I needed to talk to God. And so right there on the streets of Rwanda, I fell down on my knees and I began to talk to God. And this is what I prayed. I prayed, and this is exactly what I prayed, preacher. I prayed, God, you know that's my child, but she's also your child. I'm placing her in your hands and believing you're going to bring her back to me safely, no matter what you have to do. And she said, young preacher, I love her. She called me young. She said, young preacher, do you know in that moment that I prayed, my daughter told me that that motorbike, the motorcycle she was on, the motorcyclist lost his bearings, and as a consequence hit, don't miss this, a slick puddle in the middle of the road. And because he hit that slick puddle, the wheel began to spin out, and before you know it, he went into a wall and hit his head and passed out. When he passed out, my daughter landed on top of him. That meant that her fall was cushioned by the one that had taken her. And so my daughter then gets up and starts running. And while she's running, my brother sees her in the streets, recognizes her, says, come here, get in the car with me, drives her back to me. May I tell you what happened? One more time, I prayed. When I couldn't do it myself, when I could not get her myself, I did not have the strength, I could not run fast enough to catch her, but I talked to a God who was already where she was and told God, she ain't in my hands, she's in your hands, she's your child and my child. God, I'm counting on you to bring her back to me safely. And y'all see what God did? God turned the situation around, and the one that took her, in a real sense, was a cushion for her. I'm going to stop and shout you right there. The very folk who try to take you out, God can use them to protect you, to save you, to make sure you end up all right. I'm done, but I'm trying to let you know there is no secret what God can do. What God has done for others, God can do for you. Y'all didn't shout. I got to go old school. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. But hold on, I'm done. But I don't forget what I told you. Your prayer has power when you are conscious of a need that you can't meet yourself. And so every now and then, we got to go old school, church, and break out singing, I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour, I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. And the shout is, when you know of your need, God will hear you, meet your need. I ain't saying God is your Santa Claus who will give you every toy that you ask for. But I am saying that real prayer positions you to release power in you and your situation that wouldn't have been released had you not prayed. Last night I preached in Philadelphia, and a couple of things happened. I preached for Enon Tabernacle, and they gave me the assistant to the pastor, executive assistant, gave me a text that said, there's a nice restaurant adjacent to the hotel. You can eat there and just tell them, watch this, tell them that you are with Enon Tabernacle and your bill is taken care of. So I go to the restaurant. Y'all think I just eat all the time, but I go to the restaurant. And when I get to the restaurant, order the food. Food is good. Time for the bill. Woman brings me the bill. I said, do I just sign? She says, oh, no, we're not connected to the hotel. So I said, no. She said, would that be cash or card? I said, no. I'm with Enon Tabernacle. She said, Enon Tabernacle Baptist Church? I said, yes. Why don't you say so? And so I said, well, I thought I'd sign. She said, no, you're with Enon Tabernacle. If you had just said Enon Tabernacle, we wouldn't be going through this right now. And the point is that what happened is that if I had just used the right name, if I had just used the name I was told to use, then I wouldn't have gone through unnecessary hassle. All right, so I preached there, and that got me. So make sure you use the right name. All right, make sure you use the right name. So this morning, catch a flight back here, 5 o'clock a.m. Pray for me, I'm sleepy. And catch a flight back here, and as I'm sitting on the plane while it's at the gate, the plane hollers at me, and I'm done. Plane says, I spent the night right here with the ground crew working on me, because there's no way you're going anywhere if the ground crew hasn't done what it has to do. Tell the people that you got to spend time in prayer with the ground crew. And if you spend time in prayer with the ground crew, then you're ready to take off. Because sometimes you've got to go to your knees in order to get back on your feet. God bless you. God bless you. So, I want you right now extend this invitation, because somebody is in church or you're online. And here's the deal. Somebody prayed for you. They prayed for you to tune in. They prayed for you to show up in church. The only reason you're still alive is because you've been prayed into life. You've been prayed into life. There's some stuff that was beyond your control, but not the control of God. And God, watch this, touched the heart of your mama, your daddy, some Sunday school teacher, somebody in your life who loved you before you loved yourself. And they started praying to God about you. So the bottom line is, you ain't here by accident. God planned it, because God heard somebody's prayer. God heard somebody's prayer online. And if that's you, I want you to know right now, you're not here by accident. God planned it because somebody prayed. And so if you're here or you're online, if you're online, dial that number 469-498-0210, or join us at friendshipwest.org. Email us and we'll respond to you if you want to give your life to Jesus Christ. If you're in the house and you know good and well that you need a relationship with this God who hears and answers prayer. You need a relationship, a connection with this God who hears, answers prayer, and loves you and wants a personal relationship with you. If that's you, you're here and you're not saved, you're here and you're not connected to God, I want you right now, my brother, my sister, man, girl, boy, woman, however you self-identify, God loves you. I want you to stand up, step out of the aisle you're in, come on down out front and give your life to Jesus Christ. I'm so glad she's coming. You know why? Because you're out there and your thing is this. I don't know if it's time to move. I don't want to be the first one. And so God touched her. So now you ain't got nothing to wait on because God is speaking to you. And you know it's the right time. You're in the right place. So come on down and do the right thing. If you're here and you want to get your life straight with God, won't you right now stand up, step out, come on down, give your life to Jesus Christ. Do it right now. Preacher, here's my deal. In all honesty, I got that first part right, but I feel God leading me to join church. I'd like to join church today. If that's you, we'd love to have you. I'd love to be your pastor. So won't you right now stand up, step out, come on down, and let's join church. I see y'all coming. Come on, do it right now. Preacher, here's my deal. I used to go to church. I stopped going. I'm ready to get back in church. If that's you, that's a good thing. Stand up, step out, come on down. Let's get back in church. Preacher, this is my deal. I just moved to Dallas, Fort Worth from another area. I got a church home back there, but now I live here, work here, go to school here. I just ain't got a church home here. Today's a good day to join church. Come on down. I love it. Now you coming in a walker? If she can come in a walker, why don't you stand on up? Come on down. Give your life to Jesus Christ. Join church. Do it right now. Come on. I see y'all coming. I see y'all. Y'all, this is some good stuff. Listen, praise team is about to sing. When they sing, I'm going to ask all of us to stand. That's your signal. Don't wait. Don't hesitate. Don't vacillate. Stand up. Step out. Come on down. Give your life to Christ. Join church. Somebody prayed for you. That's why you're here. Shall we stand and won't you come?
I am God all by myself. I don't need any help. I can have all things on my own. I am the first and the last. Whatever you need, just ask.
Listen, that's good. I'm feeling that. But you out there, and I think you're feeling the music, but you're supposed to be doing what God is leading you to do. And you know who you are. God, listen, answered somebody's prayer in your life. That's why you are here. You're here because somebody prayed for you. Somebody lifted you up in prayer. And so what are you waiting on? Come on, I see you. Bless your heart. Bless your heart. Bless your heart. And so here it is, being obedient to the Spirit. The Spirit says you're still out there, and you know who you are. You know who you are. God is speaking to you, and you wrestling with God. Should I, shouldn't I? You got all these excuses. Let me tell you something right now. If you're wrestling with God, make sure you lose. And then excuses, I was taught online, are tools used by incompetent individuals to build monuments of nothing. So no excuse right now. It's worth you missing out on what God is up to in your life. And so they're going to sing again. And if you're here, wipe out the excuse. Say yes to God. Yes to the prayer. Somebody prayed for you. Come on down. Give your life to Christ. Join church. All right? Y'all sing and y'all come on down. Come on down.
I am.
Thank you that you had somebody pray for us. I pray your blessings now upon these, your children. Please bless them. Fill them in a fresh way with your spirit. Use us as their family to love on them. Connect with them. Build them up so they become everything you'd have them to become. Use us to pray for them. In Jesus' name, amen and hallelujah. Thank you. Listen, please go with our amazing ministers. They're going to share with you, pray for you, and be right here with you. Amen. Come on, y'all. Ain't this awesome? Let's praise God for our new family. Praise God for our new family. All right. Listen, it's offering time. It's offering time. All right. It's offering time. So listen, on the first Sunday of this month, it was All Tithe Sunday. We asked every member of our church to begin a new habit, a holy habit of tithing, giving God a tenth off the top of everything that God has blessed you with. And so I'm trusting that you're continuing that habit, because you can't beat God's giving no matter how you try. So please prepare now your heart to give in a way that honors God. If you're online or in the house, you can text to give 972-200-9419, or use the QR code. There should be something real close to you that you can use. Also, there's the Givelify app. You can download the Givelify app if you don't have it. If you have it, go ahead, search out Friendship West. That's a very safe vehicle. And you can give online through our website, friendshipwest.org, as well as our app, FWBC. God bless you. You can also give, of course, old school envelopes. So please get your envelope prepared, and we will give on our way out. I want to give you just a couple of announcements, and then we're going to get ready to go. Number one, well, let me do this announcement first. Tomorrow is October 16th, and it is the birthday of Ebony Joel Haynes. And so Ebony told me to let y'all know it's a holiday, and so you can take off work tomorrow. But she's not sure your boss will honor that. But just know that. And so happy birthday to your baby baba. Now, here's what I'm really excited about. I'm super excited, so proud. Our members are just, y'all are just it, okay? Y'all are it, okay? Y'all are them Christians. So check this out. Our tutoring ministry, we've kicked it up, and this year we are proudly launching our tutoring program to extend valuable support to our kids, youth, within our church, and the community. And the success of our students, of course, is linked to the future well-being of our community. And I ain't gonna read this, I'm gonna go talk. All right, so here's the deal. Y'all, we live in a state where the governor is determined to basically defund public education. So your tax dollars are going to fund the education of the rich in private schools. That's going on right now. Okay, this backward state is doing that right now. And the question becomes, so what are we gonna do? Right. Y'all, we are not helpless. Right. We got power in our hands. Right. Do you know that black folk learn how to read and write in Sunday school? That's right. in Sunday school. We didn't go to Sunday school to ask, okay, what does that verse mean to you? No. We learned how to read, write, and think in Sunday school. Okay? So we done been here before. And if they are trying to stop educating us, here's what we do. We fight against it. Fight it. At the same time, that should not be our sole source of education. We have to educate our own, and the wonderful educators in our church have come up with a tutoring program for us. Now, first of all, these are some brilliant folk teaching. I'm going to show them off real soon. But guess what? We have a greater demand of students than we have teachers. And here it is. We're going to pay them. All right? Because you get what you pay for. And so I don't want to be, you know, giving your kids a tutor who is free and acting like it. You like that, huh? Yeah. So you want a tutor who's being paid so we can say, oh, what's up? What's up? Why you show up on time? Okay? So we're paying them, but we need more teachers now because we want a healthy ratio of tutors to students. And so we're gonna pay them, but we need some more. We need some more. So since we need some more, I need y'all to help me pay for more. Okay? So I'm pleading with you, please, please, if you have a business and you'd like to do something, you're already doing what? Well, now I need you to do some good. Okay? I'm not saying you ain't doing good, but here's some good you can do that represents our future. And so I'm asking you to please, please help us to fund our educating our children. Because they don't know it, but this is the first step towards our freedom schools. All right? So I need you. So we ask business owners step forward so the students can benefit. The students benefiting from your tutoring program today will undoubtedly become the employees you hire tomorrow. I like that. So please, we ask you to give generously with a joyful heart, inspired by the Lord. Your contributions will enable us to continue supporting our vital tutoring ministry. All right. So did y'all tell me where they can give? All right. So here's what you do.
The regular app.
Okay, the regular app. All right. So I need us to give through the regular app. The regular app. Give and mark tutoring. Mark tutoring, okay? Be sure and mark tutoring, and all the resources will go in that direction. Now, I'm asking this over and above your regular tithe and offering, okay? Because we still got to do our other stuff that we do. So please, you can text to give, Givelify app, give online, scan the QR code, give in the old school envelope. But please, y'all, this is very important. This can be a game changer.
Amen.
Because my prayer is we do it so well here, I take it to all my colleagues across the state.
That's right.
All right? So I can tell y'all ready to go, so let's go. All right, shall we stand? And thank you, praise team. Y'all did the thing. What? Thank you. Thank you. All right. Y'all have a blessed and amazing week. Pray for our Rainbow Push. This is our first conference under my leadership. It's this week in Atlanta. It's the Opportunity Conference. Thank you, dear. It's the Opportunity Conference, Creating Opportunity Conference. And so we'll be in the ATL Thursday and Friday. So please, please pray for a successful conference. I hope y'all have an amazing week, productive week, a peaceful week. I'm going to ask we close out by praying. We're going to pray about what's happening in the Middle East, because really it's a bloodbath. I mean, they're telling them they got so much time to get out, and then you shut off the exits. People are dying. Human beings, God's children. But I know when we can't think it through or work it through, we can pray it through. Let's talk to God. God, in the name of Jesus, I thank you and praise you that there's nothing too hard for you. What's too complex and complicated for us, you're omniscient. You're omnicompetent. You're omnipotent. You know all about it, and you can handle it. And so right now, God, I stand in the gap as we touch and agree for the massacre going on in what is called the Middle East. God, I pray that you would touch the hearts of those who are leaders. Change their minds. Give them a sense of compassion. And may they know that revenge is never justice. May they know that the best way to bring about healing is for there to be peace. And the only way for there to be peace is for there to be justice. And so, God, I pray first for every family that has been hit and hurt and heartbroken because of the loss of loved ones to the senseless violence. Oh God, heal them. Walk them through this grief season. Protect them. Grant them your peace and yes, your healing. And then God, I pray your blessings. Oh my God, I pray your blessings upon those who have lost children. Children slain. Oh God, have mercy. I pray for the children who've lost parents. I lift up in prayer that you would bring healing to a broken area. Please, God, heal, bless, grant your peace as only you can. God, we're touching and agreeing, and we're asking you to intervene as only you can. I don't know how you're gonna do it, but I trust you. I believe in you. So have your way in Jesus' name. Now the Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. The Lord cause God's face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of God's countenance upon you. Grant you peace. Go now in the power of God's Holy Spirit, knowing that when life knocks you down, you can get back on your feet if you go to your knees. In Jesus' name, amen. Give a shout out to our Justice Ministry. Thank you.
We praise God for this impactful experience and for your joining us during it. Check us out on social media and please like, share, and subscribe at Friendship West. Then go to www.friendshipwest.org to find out more about this marvelous movement. Find out how to participate through sharing your prayers, sharing your offerings or monetary gifts, or sharing and investing your time volunteering with this difference-making ministry. For you who are viewing as visitors, you can share that you are here by taking time to text FWVIZ to the number 28950. For those who want to, this time that you are visiting to be the last time that you're a visitor, you can become part of our fabulous family of faith, either by calling 469-498-0210 or by emailing joinus@friendshipwest.org with your first name, your last name, and your cell number. Either way, we look forward to hearing from you. We're so excited that you are here. Until next time, blessings on you.